Hello and good evening. Welcome to our Triumphant Tuesdays in the Word. I am excited tonight about what God is going to share with us through His Word. Let's take our Bible and let's our electronic devices and let's prepare to dive right into the Word of God here on tonight. We're going to go to the Old Testament book of Leviticus, Leviticus chapter number 19, Leviticus chapter 19. And we're going to go to verse number 18. That is Leviticus chapter 19. And we're going to go down to verse number 18. Listen at what the Word of God says. It says, "You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." This is the Word of God for the people of God, and we say thanks be unto God. Let us take our Bible, our electronic devices that contains your holy copy, your copy rather, of the holy text, and let's repeat our statement of faith. This is my Bible. I believe what it says. I can have what it says I can have. I can be what it says I can be, and I can do what it says I can do. Amen, amen, and amen. Listen, Leviticus chapter number 19 and verse number 18. Allow me to read it one more time. Someone might have just logged on. It says, "You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself." We're picking up our lesson wherein we've been talking about the journey of forgiveness, the journey of forgiveness. And on this journey, we are making stops. It's like taking a trip out of town. We're taking a trip out of town, taking a trip on the journey of forgiveness. And so far, we've made two stops. Our very first stop that we made, that stop was a stop called Bear With One Another. Bear with one another. In that lesson, we taught and began to expose us to the fact that if you're going to forgive, you have to learn how to bear with one another. You have to learn how to bear with one another. But then on our second stop, after stopping number one at the stop called Bear With One Another, we stopped at our second stop, and it was a stop called Love One Another. Love one another. Love one another. If you're going to forgive, you have to learn how to love one another. This third stop that we're stopping on here tonight is a stop that I call Let It Go, a stop called Let It Go. If you're going to forgive, you're going to learn how to forgive people, whether it's husbands and wives, whether it's people who are dating, boyfriend and girlfriend, whether it's a coworker that has offended you, friend that has offended you, something that perhaps your child has done towards you, in order to forgive, you must learn how to let it go. You must learn how to let it go. You must learn how to let it go. This third stop, it bursts out of an Old Testament pericope that gives laws to the nation of Israel as to how to live holy. And this requisite of how of living holy, this requisite for them to live holy is because the Lord their God is holy. They are to be holy. They are to live holy because the Lord their God is holy. And our launching pad tonight comes to us out of the 18th verse, out of that 19th chapter of Leviticus. And we focus on this particular prohibition that speaks out against seeking vengeance and bearing a grudge. This prohibition in the 18th verse out of the 19th chapter of Leviticus, it speaks out against seeking out vengeance and bearing a grudge. This would mean that the individual that is spoken to is someone who has been offended. They have been offended. And so this word is for the offended, and it created a requisite to look at one of the major hindrances to forgiveness, and that is the ability to let go of an offense. So this word, it talks to the person, you know, you've been offended, again, by whomever, husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, friend, family member, cousin, coworker, but you've been offended. And so this particular verse in the 19th chapter of the book of Leviticus, what it does is that this prohibition, it speaks out against seeking revenge, seeking vengeance. So somebody's offended you, we want to get revenge, we want vengeance. Or somebody's offended you and you are holding a grudge. This particular verse in this chapter, as well as supporting verses throughout the Bible, teaches us that you must learn how to let it go. You must learn how to let it go. You cannot, it prohibits seeking vengeance, as well as it prohibits you holding a grudge. And so we must learn how to let go of the offense. Allow me to give us tonight some of the common barriers that exist when it comes down to forgiveness and it comes down to letting go. Number one, the reason why it's hard is because there has been no modeling of forgiveness from parents or from leaders or from friends. So with that, we hear people saying, I don't know how to forgive. So if they've never seen an image or a model of forgiveness, they don't know how to forgive. Another barrier is denying that the offense ever occurred. Denying that the offense ever occurred. People walk around, they've been offended, and they'll say, I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to think about it. That is a barrier to forgiveness. Also, another barrier to forgiveness is fearing to hold the guilty accountable, a fear of holding the guilty accountable. And so that barrier, the person will just say, hey, it's all my fault. It's all my fault. It's all my fault. And it's all my fault. And the reason why they'll say it's all my fault is because there is a fear of holding the guilty accountable. Another barrier is not feeling that you can forgive yourself. So another barrier, again, is not feeling that you can forgive yourself. And so therefore, people will say, no mercy for me, no mercy for you. No mercy for me, no mercy for you. So then that the feeling of the fear of the feeling rather of not being able to forgive yourself, the feeling of not being able to forgive yourself. But then also another barrier says not being, or perhaps here's the barrier, not being, you haven't been forgiven in your past. So you haven't been forgiven. So you walk around and say, well, they didn't forgive me. Why should I forgive them? Or someone else never forgave me. And so then you walk around not being able to forgive others, not being forgiven for past offenses. Another barrier is believing that bitterness is a required response to betrayal. Believing that bitterness is a required response to betrayal. And so we'll try to appease this or justify this by saying, God knows my feelings, and these feelings are normal. And so we tend to believe that bitterness is a required response to being betrayed. Another barrier to forgiving and letting go is thinking that forgiveness excuses unjust behavior. Later on in our lesson, not tonight, but later on this journey, I want to talk about that. Thinking that forgiveness excuses unjust behavior. Another barrier is requiring an apology or a show of repentance. You know, they didn't apologize. They didn't show no level of remorse or repentance. And so it becomes a barrier to being able to forgive or let go. But also the feeling a sense of power. There's a feeling of a sense of power by hanging on to unforgiveness. It puts you in control of the situation, puts you in control of the relationship, a feeling of a sense of power because you hang on and you hold it over people's heads. You hang on to unforgiveness. But then also another barrier is refusing to turn loose of revenge, refusing to turn loose of revenge. Let's go a little bit further in our lesson here on tonight. Because when we look at those barriers that we mentioned, and I hope that you wrote them down and you look at a mirror, not through a window, but look at a mirror at oneself. Any of these barriers could prove to be a roadblock. They could prove to be a roadblock on the journey to forgiveness. Our text, it helps us to see that at the heart of not letting go is the thought that it wouldn't be fair. At the heart of not letting go is the thought that it would not be fair. It wouldn't be fair to let go of the offense. It would not be fair. And so our text says in Leviticus chapter 19 and verse number 18, it says, "You shall not take vengeance. You shall not take vengeance." The sense or the need for justice is the Achilles heel to forgiveness. In humanity, the need for justice is strong and natural. While on the other hand, forgiveness is difficult and it's so unnatural. Allow me to say that again. In humanity, the need for justice is strong and it is natural. While on the other hand, forgiveness is difficult and it is unnatural. So we must ask the question, why is this? Let me give you three reasons. I believe the reason this is because God has instilled within every human being a sense of right and wrong, a sense of right and wrong. Paul over in the in Romans chapter number 2, verses 14 and 15, when he was speaking about the Gentiles, who word utilized for unbelievers in Christian texts, the Gentiles as unbelievers, he said the Gentiles who did not even have the law naturally seek to obey the law. They seek to fulfill the law. They don't even know what the law is. But naturally, so God has instilled in every human being a sense of right and wrong. Secondly, based on the law, the Old Testament law, forgiveness seems inappropriate. And based upon the laws of the land, forgiveness seems to be inappropriate. But then the third reason why I believe that that there is a need for justice and it's so strong in us and it's natural and forgiveness is difficult and unnatural. The third thing is that we feel outrage. We feel outrage when justice is denied. We feel outrage when justice is denied. The word vengeance, nakam in the Hebrew, it carries the meaning to hurt or punish, a punishment that is done to another for wrong, that is given to another or done to another for wrong that they have committed to you. Therefore, the text is saying that God's people are not to take and to repay wrong with hurt or punishment. God, hear me out, God does not share vengeance. God does not share vengeance. He has declared in his word unequivocally that vengeance belongs to him. God, let me say it one more time, does not share vengeance. We must get it in our, it's above our pay grade. It's not our responsibility. God does not share vengeance. He's declared unequivocally that, listen, vengeance belongs to him. It belongs to him. Let's go over, let's get our Bible, our electronic devices, and let's go over to the book of Romans, Romans chapter 12 and verse number 19, and listen at what the word of God says. Romans chapter 12 and verse number 19. God says in his word, he says, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. All right, let's go over to the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse number 35, and let's listen at what that word of God says. It says, vengeance is mine and recompense for the time when their foot shall slip. For the day of their calamity is at hand and their doom comes swiftly. Let's go take our Bibles and let's go over to Psalms 94 and verse number 1 and listen at what the word calls God. The word of God, Psalms 94, verse number 1, listen at what it calls God. It says, O Lord, God of vengeance, God of vengeance, shine forth. Do you hear that in the text? God is called the God of vengeance. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 20 and verse number 22. Listen at what the word of God, it says, do not say, I will repay evil. Wait for the Lord and he will deliver you. You hear that? Tells us, wait for the Lord. You wait for the Lord. Don't try to repay evil. It says, wait for the Lord. God will deliver you. So Proverbs 24 and verse number 29. Listen at what it says. Do not say, I will do him as he has done to me. Don't miss it. I'm going to say that one more time. Do not say, I will do to him as he has done to me. I will pay the man back for what he has done. So we see in these verses that when we have been offended, when we have been done wrong, that we should not have the mindset that says, I'm going to do to them what they did to me. We see in these verses that it teaches us that we should not try to repay evil. We shouldn't repay evil. But we're taught in these verses that we ought to wait on the Lord. God, he will deliver us. But then, listen, we're also taught in these scriptures that God is the God of vengeance. God is the God of vengeance. In other words, one can say that he's so good at giving vengeance that his name is the God of vengeance. But then he declares out of his mouth in the Old Testament, it says there that he says, vengeance is mine. In other words, it belongs to me. God said, it belongs to me. I know you want to do it. I know you want to do the big payback. I know you want to do the get back. I know you want to do it yourself. You want to do it yourself. But God says, as his child, vengeance belongs to me. Vengeance belongs to me. These verses that we just looked at, it clearly shows that the reason for not seeking revenge, although it's natural to want to get somebody back, Lord have mercy. Although it is natural to want to repay somebody when they've done you wrong, broken your heart, lied on you, spread rumors about your family or falsities about you and your personhood or your finances or your boss continues to overlook you. It's natural to want to get vengeance. However, the Bible teaches us that vengeance, it belongs to God. It belongs to God. It is prohibited to seek revenge. It is prohibited to seek revenge. Vengeance, God says, belongs to me. But not only in this text do we see here, that we should not, that we don't seek vengeance, but also the text, Leviticus 19, verse 18 says, you shall not bear a grudge. You shall not bear a grudge. Our text, it also points that what it is that feeds the desire, it points out rather, what feeds the desire for revenge is when you hold a grudge. When you hold a grudge, what feeds the desire to want to get revenge is when you're holding a grudge, the text says, don't seek revenge, but it also don't bear a grudge. Don't bear a grudge. That phrase, bear grudge, is natar in the Hebrew, and it carries the meaning to keep. It also means to keep guard. It also means to maintain, and that phrase also means to watch over. It gives the imagery like the offense now belongs to you, the offended, the offense belongs to you. And bearing a grudge, that phrase in the Hebrew, natar, then gives the imagery that the person that is offended acts like a guard dog, making sure that no one takes the sting, the stench, or the pain, or the feeling of the offense away from them. You watch over it. You watch over it. And when you feel that it's not there, you go to make sure that the feeling is there. You make sure that the feeling is there. And whenever this phrase, bear grudge, natar in the Hebrew, is applied to humanity, it carries the meaning to store up anger towards another person. You store up anger, so you're watching over it. And the more and more you watch over it, the more and more anger. And you take that anger and you store it up. You watch over it, make sure it hasn't left. And you take that anger and you store it up. You watch over it, make sure you keep guard, make sure no one can take that offense away from it. And you get angry and you store it up. It keeps compiling and compiling and compiling. It's sort of like a volcano, and it gets to a place to where it begins to ooze and it begins to erupt and explode because you've been storing it up. And the person who stores up anger against another person tends to wait for the opportune time to take and to vent that anger, because they've been storing it up, they've been holding on to it, and the desire for vengeance, it takes and it moves one to seek the harm of the offender, person that has offended you. Now your vengeance, a desire for vengeance, has been fed and fueled by the fact that you are holding on to the grudge. You're holding on to the fence. You're watching over it, and it's being fueled, and it's fueling and fueling the desire for vengeance. And as that desire continues to take and to get to a higher height, that desire for vengeance, it will lead you to a place to where you want to harm, whether physically harm, whether emotionally harm, whether mentally, physically, emotionally, whatever it may be, financially, professionally. We hold on to it for so long. We've held that grudge. We've watched over it. We've guarded it and would not let it go, and it has fueled the desire for vengeance, and now you're seeking to harm the person who has caused you to feel this way. Saints of God, because of the grave danger of bearing a grudge and holding on to the fence, we must let it go. We must let it go. I'm going to give you a few suggestions here, and I'll leave you alone here on tonight. A few things for you to write down, for you to pray over, and for you to consider as we're on this journey on this journey of forgiveness. Here it is. The question is, How do you let go? How do you let go? Well, here are a few suggestions. Pain, you must understand, pain should never stand in the way of forgiveness. Pain should never stand in the way of forgiveness. Forgiveness, secondly, forgiveness is far more powerful than the most overwhelming pain. Forgiveness is far more powerful than the most overwhelming pain. Third thing, trust must be placed in God even when you've been offended. Trust must be placed in God even when you've been offended. There's a fourth thing. You must never keep a record of offenses. You must never keep a record of file storing up. You must never keep a record of offenses. Fifthly, you can't keep reliving the offenses. If you're going to let go, you can't keep reliving the offenses. Sixth thing, if you're going to let go, you must acknowledge your thoughts and then give them to God. Acknowledge your thoughts, you know, what you're thinking about this, and acknowledge them and give them to God. Another thing, if you're going to let go, you must meditate on God's word and speak his word aloud. You must meditate on God's word and then speak his word aloud. Psalms 107 and verse 20, it says he sent forth his word and his word healed them. His word healed them. Another thing, if you're going to let go, you must pray for the offender. Pray for the offender. I know that's a great challenge, but you must pray for the offender. Another thing, if you're going to let go, you must practice forgiving wrongs daily. This will help ensure that you're not storing up all of these offenses. You must practice every single day. You must practice forgiving. Forgive daily. Don't take an offense from today, Tuesday, into your Wednesday, Wednesday into your Thursday, so on and so forth. But you must practice forgiving daily. But then I would also say, if you're going to learn to let it go, you need to surround yourself with supportive people, a supporting cast who will tell you the truth, who will tell you the truth. You don't need people around to help you to stay angry, to help you to stay unforgiving, but you need some people around you that's going to, some supportive people that are going to tell you the truth. So here it is. We must, if you're going to forgive, we must learn how to let it go. We must learn how to let it go. The text says to us in verse number 18 of the book of Leviticus, chapter number 18, it says unto us that, watch this, you shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge. You must, if you're going to forgive, must learn how to let it go. Let me pray with us here on tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would look down upon us, Lord. Some of us, we've been hurt. We've been lied on. We've been mistreated. We've been taken advantage of. And Father, as much as we try to move away and move on, Lord, we continue to rehearse. We continue to feel that pain. Thoughts and memories goes back to the pain. Lord, I'm praying tonight that you would give us the strength and the wherewithal, Lord, to be able to let it go. Father, that we would truly be able to forgive and be healed. And God, as this is done, we know we can't do it on our own might and under our own power, but we know we can only do it by your power and your might. We pray this today in faith in Jesus Christ's name. Amen, amen, and amen. Well, listen, I pray that this word on tonight begins to point you in the right direction on this journey of forgiveness, and that we are finding our way, moving closer to having a heart that's able to forgive. My prayer for each and every one of us is that we will learn how to let it go. We will learn how to let go of those offenses that have been committed against us. Listen, I want to tell you, saints of God, Sunday mornings, 9 o'clock a.m. We invite you to come and to join us live virtually. You can view us from wherever you're located. You can view us on YouTube. You can view us on Facebook. You can view us on Twitter live Sunday mornings, 9 o'clock a.m. And then for those of you who have a desire to physically come in the sanctuary, we are here. But if you come on a Sunday morning, remember, you must wear a mask, and we are socially distancing while we're in the sanctuary. We're keeping our hands clean by washing them and sanitizing them while we're here in the sanctuary, and then as well as in your regular life, amen, outside of the sanctuary as well. We also then invite you to come back and join us again Tuesday nights for our Tuesday nights at 7 o'clock p.m. for our Triumphant Tuesdays in the Word. Triumphant Tuesdays in the Word. You can come and you can join us again, our Triumphant Tuesdays in the Word. I want to say to each of us, for those of you who've been faithful in the area of your giving, continue to do so. Take advantage of these various ways to give. You're not doing it because of me. You're not doing it because of the physical church, but you're doing it because of your faith in God. And in your faith in God, it encourages you to be faithful in the area of your giving. I also want to encourage you to stay faithful in going, coming to church. You may not catch us right at 9, but you can always go back to Facebook. You can go back to YouTube. You can go back to Twitter Live, and you can check our feed, and you will see the service. You may not watch it at 9, but you can always go back and view it at a later time, and you can get your family together and worship together. Same things with our Triumphant Tuesdays in the Word. I want to encourage you to stay faithful to God, amen, in the area of your finances, but in the area of your worshiping Him through these two platforms. I also want to encourage you to pray for our country. Pray ye for one another. Let's just pray that God's will would be done. Until we can come together again on these various platforms and outlets, listen, I encourage you to stay safe. I encourage you to stay healthy. I encourage you to stay prayed up. Listen, I love you in Jesus. Peace.